I want to call your mind back to something in particular, which is that we looked at uniform distributions. You remember those? They're really simple. Everything in your situation is the same probability, right? And we've also looked at a bunch that are not uniform, right? Some of them are like increasing, some are decreasing, some wiggle around, all that kind of thing. And so we've just looked at all different kinds of, like, all of these things. They're all just random other different shapes, right? Now, what we've kind of not been talking about is the fact that there is one shape for our probability distribution that is more important than all the rest of the shapes. It's like the, I don't know if there are any Lord of the Rings fans here, right? But it's like one distribution to rule them all. And it's the one that's on the piece of paper I snuck onto your desk just now. It's what we call the normal distribution, okay? Now, you might sort of colloquially, and you're welcome to write this, by the way. You might look at this shape and say, I know what this is. This is called the bell curve, right? The bell curve. Okay, because it looks like a bell. Maybe that's not where your brain goes, okay? But it turns out that this guy, the normal distribution, it's, like I said, it's kind of the single most important distribution that exists in the world. And there are lots of reasons for that. Number one, it happens all the time. Anytime you have something which is the product of lots of independent factors, like how tall you are, what temperature it is, what scores you get on a test. Anytime when there's lots of independent things contributing to something, you get this shape, the normal distribution, okay? So because it happens so frequently, we're kind of really interested in it. So what I want you to do with me is to note some of the characteristics about this, and then we're gonna sort of dig into what you can do with it once you understand it. So the first thing is you can see that mu there. What does mu stand for again? That's the mean, right? The mean. The first thing that you notice is that this distribution, I hope you can see, it's kind of the same on both sides, right? What word would we use to describe that? It starts with this. It's symmetrical, right? So the normal distribution is symmetrical about the mean, about mu, right? Now, speaking of mu, mu is right there in the center of the data, quite literally, right? So if you looked above mu and below mu, the area under the curve is the same, right? So because this is a probability density function, if both of those halves are the same, then the area should equal what? Each different side of it, the left and the right.
Half,
right? Yeah, exactly. So we have a name for that value. It's not just the mean, it's also the median, right? It's that middle point. And not only are the mean and the median the same, but look, the mean is also on the highest point of the probability density function, which is to say it's also the mode, right? So all three measures of central tendency are the same on the normal distribution, okay? And the other thing you notice is that the edges of the bell, if you like, they get closer and closer to the x-axis, but they never reach. We have a name for that, right? We call it asymptotic, right? So A-S-Y-M-P-T-O-T-I-C. Asymptotic. Well, actually, some people spell it without the P, but anyway, whatever. Okay, say that again. Asymptotic. So that's the adjective for asymptote, okay? Now, once you've got these characteristics, when you notice this kind of shape, right, what we start to realize is because you can start to compare lots of different things, instead of saying, oh, your score is high because it's this number, or it's low because it's this number, we want to try and describe in terms of common characteristics. So firstly we say, I need another color here, we describe how high or low a score is based on how far it is above or below that middle value, right? Which is both the median, or not both, it's the median and it's the mode, and it's also, most importantly for us, it's the mean. Okay? So we might say, you know, yeah, I scored 50, that doesn't sound very good, but I was above the mean, right? So where the average is really matters in terms of whether something is high or low or good or bad, right? But then we want to go one step further. We say it is in terms of the standard deviation, because if you have, and I'm going to give you an example of this in a second, if you have a data set, oh, by the way, what was that symbol that we used, that Greek letter? It's a sigma, right? It's like a little O with a little line there, okay? The standard deviation tells us if you've got a very, very closely bunched set of scores, right? So you've got a low standard deviation, then to go above that is a really big achievement. Whereas if you've got a very spread out set of data, right? And you're like, oh, I'm above average. And you're like, yeah, but it's easy to get above average by one or two marks because lots of people are above by one or two because everyone's spread out, okay? So we have a name for this particular thing. When we tell you how high or low something is, in terms of the mean and the standard deviation, we call this the Z score. I'm putting it nice and bold because of how important it is. Okay? Okay. No. I know you might think Z, like 3D coordinates, but Z is just the name for, and I'm going to give you an equation for the Z score. And if you've heard the phrase Z score before, this is what it means. Z equals, it's a fraction. So what we do is we say, firstly, tell me how far you are away from the mean. This is something we remember from expected value, from variance, right? So we might say, what's your score? And then what you do is you subtract the mean from that. So do you remember this from working out variance? Okay, it's like, how far away are you? So that's x minus mu. And then what we do is we say, well, divide that now by the standard, divide that by the standard deviation. Okay, the sigma, very good. Now, like I said, I'm going to give you an example of this. So maybe turn over your piece of paper, because we're going to come back to the bottom of this in a second. And I want you to draw a table like this with me. Okay, so suppose you have a student, maybe it's you, they've done two tests, and they have scores that seem very similar. They score 75% on both tests. And you go ahead and you ask the teacher, oh, okay, well, I know 75 doesn't tell me very much. Tell me what the average was. So they tell you the mean on those tests was, well, by coincidence, you find out the mean for both of them is 60, right? Now, off of this information here, it looks like, well, I guess I did about the same in both tests. But like I was mentioning before, the standard deviation for each test changes this completely. Let me give you an example. Let's suppose if for English, you then ask the teacher, because you're like, I've done random variables. I know to ask questions like this. What is the standard deviation for my English test? And they tell you it's 10, okay? Let's go ahead and work out what your Z score is using that formula which we've just written down, okay? The Z score will be, I'll write it just up above so you can have it there, X minus mu on sigma. X, your score, take away the mean. So that's your score. There's the mean. And then you divide by your standard deviation. Okay, so let's just work out what it is for these numbers, okay? You're gonna get 75, take away 60, that's x minus mu, and I divide by 10 in this case, because that's your standard deviation. Now 75 take away 60, that's 15. So 15 divided by 10 would be 1.5. So we would say you got a Z score of 1.5 for your English, and that's great. That means you're above average. We already knew that, but this shows you how much you're above average. Now, suppose you then go and ask the same question in science, and they tell you, oh, the standard deviation for science was only 6. Now, before we go ahead and calculate the next thing, think about what that means. Standard deviation is a measure of spread. How far is everyone sort of distributed across the different marks, okay? So when your standard deviation is only 6 compared to 10, what does that tell you? Everyone's kind of bunched in more. Does that make sense? Everyone is bunched in more. Now look at what that means for your Z score. Let's do the same calculation. It's still X minus mu on the top, but then you divide by 6 because that's the standard deviation here. Now if you go ahead and pop that into your calculator, it's 2.5. Now just look at that for a second, right? We knew that your Z score for English was good, 1.5. But look at your Z score for science. It's way higher. What this is telling you is how many standard deviations you are above or below, if you were below the average, below the mean. Now, remember I said to you, if you just look at this over here, you might be tempted to think, oh, I scored 75, average is 60. So I did about the same in both of them. But for science, because everyone is so much more bunched together, it's a bigger deal that you were 15 marks above average. Does that make sense? You are 2.5 standard deviations above average. So that's like, wow, you're kind of a freak of nature to have done that well on this test. Does that make sense? So do you see how when you guys ask us like, oh, did I get above 50% or below 50%? That doesn't matter as much as, what it is in terms of the standard deviation. That's why Z scores are the things that truly are useful.
That's the ATAR.
So the ATAR has more to do with that again. Okay, it's about percentiles, which I haven't really talked about here. Okay, so now let's have a look at, and this will give you a sense for what does 1.5 or 2.5 mean. What we're comparing is Z scores. What do they tell you about where you sit in the population? Okay, so these graphs of the normal distribution, you might notice on these bottom graphs, you've got numbers, right? 1, 2, 3, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3. And you can see this is no longer an x-axis. You can see it on your piece of paper. I hope it came out in the printout. This is a z-axis now, right? So what this tells you is, if you went and said, oh, that z-score of 1.5, that's around here, between 1 and 2, right? So there's your score. That's where you are in the population. Okay, so the Z scores tell you, actually it's the wrong color, sorry. They tell you where you are relative to everyone else. So if you have a Z score between negative 1 and 1, what that corresponds to is, and I've printed this out multiple times so you can color it in, what that corresponds to is between these two parts of the normal distribution, from negative 1 to 1. We'll get to the exact equation of this line later on, but once you have that, it turns out that you get about 2/3, 68% of all scores sit between negative 1 and 1, sit between one standard deviation below and one standard deviation above. That's most of the population, okay? Now, if you go one more standard deviation out, so if you go from negative 2 to 2, you can see you're now coloring in this larger section of the population. So when you have a look at that area under the curve, that's a lot more than 68%, right? Turns out it's about 95. Okay, so 95% of the population is within two standard deviations of the mean. Now if you go one more out, and you can go further obviously, but this is as far as we tend to go. If you go one more standard deviation out, so your Z score is between negative 3 and 3, this captures 99.7%, which sounds like a very funny number, I know, but it comes from the actual equation of the normal distribution. So that's between Z scores negative 3 and 3. So you can see, for that score of science, you know, I told you you had a Z score of 2.5, right? So you're somewhere around here. So you're better than 95% of that middle population. In fact, better than more than that. But you're not better than 99.7. Okay, so you can see that's you have to be really, really far up above to get a score that high. Now you might feel like that 68, 95, 99.7. That seems very random. That sounds like really hard numbers to remember, which is why we don't make you remember them. They are on. Wait for it. The reference sheet. There it is. So, on the statistical analysis section, I want to point out a few things to you, okay? For starters, right here up in the top, look at that, Z equals, what's that? X take away the mean divided by the standard deviation, right? So there's that formula right there. Here is that bell curve, and they even tell you all of the numbers. They don't give you pretty shading, of course. We can do that ourselves. But you've got 68% of scores in the middle, then 95% as you go further out, then 99.7. And hopefully this stuff down here is also ringing a bell. There's your expected value. And then what's underneath E of X? What's that? That's variance, right? And the different ways for working out variance, which we had a look at last lesson. Okay? So, take a breath. This idea of the normal distribution is really, really useful. All of the stuff that we've been looking at so far, which is quite theoretical, all these, you're like, oh, some random function which happens to be your probabilities, right? That's going to very quickly give way to stuff that looks like, let me pull it out in your booklet here. You're going to very quickly see that we can now start thinking about actual concrete situations where you get given real numbers and real quantities and you want to say, is that above average? Is it very above average? How can I tell? It's all in terms of your Z scores and standard deviations. Okay?